would never have discovered pizza or muscles.
Or Splinter, Master Splinter.
Well, he's the one who found us, got us all together.
Let's face it, folks. We're the Fab Four of the 90s.
One green, and two green. Yep.
Yeah, yeah.
This is our story.
We were awesome.
Hey, dudes and dudettes, it's the Turtles. Those bodacious, wisecracking, green superheroes on the half shell, and they're back.
Bossa Nova?
What makes them so popular?
God, I love being a turtle!
God, I love being a turtle!
Where does this turtle mania come from that has swept the country?
I like them because they eat the weirdest kind of pizza that I've ever seen.
The new Turbo Ginsu! Woohoo! It dices, it slices, and yet makes french fries in three different...
Just the word cowabunga, when you say that, people have said it makes you feel good.
Cowabunga!
We've gone behind the shells to find out who they are, where they've come from, how they are brought to life in the movies, and why kids line up at theaters from New York to Tokyo to see their exciting adventures.
Donnie, give it up.
Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles are one of the most amazing phenomena in history. There are toys, games, clothes, food. The Turtles do have parents. They are Kevin Eastman and Peter Laird, who put up their last $2,000 to create the comic book of their dreams.
Peter and I came up with the Ninja Turtles, the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, in a lot of ways out of a love of comics and out of some silliness. So late one night after watching some bad TV, feeling really silly, I did this drawing of a turtle with a mask on and nunchucks strapped to his arms to make Peter laugh.
So then I had to do my own version of it and changed a few things, tweaked it a little bit, and threw it back at Kevin, kind of dueling sketches, and ended up Kevin made a drawing of four turtles, each with a different martial arts weapon. And in pencil, which I inked and added to his Ninja Turtles, Teenage Mutant. So then we had Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. That was the beginning of it.
I want to stress that we were laughing to kill ourselves at the time. Sort of chucked the drawing aside. And the next morning we get up and looked at the drawing again and said, geez, we should really come up with a story to tell how they got to be Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. And that's when we started on the first issue.
The characters of the Turtles could be pretty easily summed up by saying Leonardo is the leader, Raphael is the hot-headed one, Michelangelo is the fun-loving goof, and Donatello is the gadget guy.
The combination of the four different personalities works really well. They play off of each other really well. They, being brothers and the personalities and the differences they have, they fight and have arguments, but they really come together in times of trouble.
Oh, no more?
The Shredder, we were looking for, is probably one of the silliest way that we came up with the character. They have these cheese graters, they're rectangular in shape with a handle on the bottom. And I was drying this off, and this was around the time we were really excited in developing the story for the Turtles, and I slid my hand into it and held on to the end, so we had these graters, these cheese graters sticking out. It's like, could you imagine a character with weapons on his arms like this? You know, the guy would be lethal.
Face the Shredder.
And we were like, Shredder, oh, what a name for a character. Right. And so that's sort of where Shredder came from.
I mean, he ended up not having cheese graters on his arm. that was his humble beginning.
The Shredder.
maybe all that hardware's for making coleslaw. You
are still. Well, Splinter is the father figure of the Turtles. He's their wise mentor. He's a Yoda type. Actually, his name is a parody of the name of a teacher of a Marvel Comics character called Daredevil, whose teacher was named Stick. So he said, well, why not Splinter? Kind of a chip off the old block, if you will.
I suggest we all meditate now on the events of this evening.
One of the major appealing things about the Turtles for kids is that they don't go out looking for trouble, and they want to be left alone to do their own thing. But when trouble comes, they can handle themselves. And I think that's really how most kids and most people, most adults, want to be. You know, they don't want to have trouble. They don't want to, you know, go out and be mean to people. But they want to be able to take care of themselves when somebody hassles them. And that's exactly what the Turtles can do.
The Turtles only fight because they must, to save the city from the evil Shredder and his gang of thugs called the Foot, who are stealing everything that is not tied down. Along the way, we learn that they were mutated in some strange ooze, and that it's very hard to be both a ninja and a teenager.
Anger clouds the mind. Turned inward, it is an unconquerable enemy.
The first movie ends with the Turtles saving the city.
Like this one suffering from shell shock.
And the Shredder falling to his death, or so we think.
We try to continue off from where the first movie ended. The real unanswered question was the ooze. Where did it come from? What was it? And what would be in that to cause the Turtles to mutate?
Eastman and Laird's characters are back in a new action adventure with a few new twists.
Okay, ready, and action.
A, 67Z. This is the fun part. Look, I don't believe this.
This movie has all the bodacious turtle comedy and hilarious teenage wisecracks that kids all over the world have come to love.
Primo Bros.
Turtle Rebecca.
Max Amundo.
The Shredder has returned, and he is out for
revenge. Some are the very...
The Turtles are hot on the trail of where they came from and how they were mutated.
Our transformation. But the answers have always remained hidden in the past.
Joining me on the final day of...
The world is threatened by toxic environmental waste.
Well, you're the last one, aren't you?
And Toka the Snapping Turtle and Razor the Wolf are on the loose.
Didn't we see these guys on WrestleMania?
I think what we're making is we're making the E-ride at Disneyland.
Watching, everybody?
The turtle combination of elements is a wild thing in this movie. You've got puppeteering.
Take the big
you've
one.
Got
Don't you take
mime
the big
work.
One.
You've got ninja martial arts, and all of it combines to make a turtle.
Please, please, a moment to reflect.
Okay. I think Michelangelo is a very warm character in this film, and I think that he really always finds the humorous side to every situation.
Hey, guys, check this. Wax on, wax off, wax on.
Mouth off.
Donatello is more sensitive in this picture and more articulate.
Serial numbers. Well, I could try, but if the database is coded, the whole system might go down.
Leonardo is very much the serious one. and the character who tries to lead the others.
Still a little more stuff to help with, Michelangelo.
Hey, I'm helping Donnie.
Raphael is a much more humorous character in this movie. He is not as angry as he was in the first movie.
Aha! Touchdown! Yeah!
One of the things that's great about the Turtles, one of the biggest achievements that occurred in the first movie and in the creation of these characters, is you believe them. It's not that they're real. The kids know that they're actors in suits and that the heads are, you know, remote controlled. In fact, they're fascinated by it, but they believe them.
I'm the cool dude, Michelangelo. Your favorite and mine. I love surfing. I love pizzas. I love life. Didn't do that very well, did you? Let's try again.
The Turtles, Splinter, and the new characters Toka and Razor are brought to life by Jim Henson's Creature Shop.
And go!
The technique that makes you believe that these creatures are almost real is called animatronics. It's a space-age form of puppetry where the puppeteer uses a computer and radio controls to animate his creature.
First, we should observe the ancient ritual of the, traditional
pre-fight donut!
Yeah!
Technically, how it works, you have the puppeteer who has his controls. He's standing off camera. Then you have the actor who's inside the suit with the mechanical head on, and the puppeteer's actions are transmitted by one of our special computers to the turtle head.
You've got the motor sounds that's constantly going on. You can't see.
That's where we see her, right there.
Oh, I shouldn't show that. And you've got the sound from your puppeteer, because you can talk to him. And you've got, in the other ear, you've got the sound from the common feed, which is everybody talking together. And then you have whatever's going on in the outside world, which also filters through as well. So it's basically like being in Grand Central at rush hour with a tin can over your head. It's a lot of fun.
You've got two people who are doing the character, so you have to really work together as one. You've got to be thinking in the same way, helping each other out. Misha's coming up with the body stuff, and I'm coming up with the face, and we have to be really together. And have a sense of fun about it, enjoy it.
Now I know what a postal package feels like. You take the ugly one.
No, you take the ugly one.
I'll take the ugly one.
Oh, which one's the ugly one?
I decided to make Leonardo the most ninja-like of all the turtles. I wanted to make him, in every situation, to come out shining in Splinter's eyes.
Leonardo?
Yeah.
What can we say about Leo?
Whoa, boring.
Just like
that. Yeah.
Why,
yeah.
If I was to talk to Raphael, I would say, you gotta lighten up, dude. You gotta just chill out, go with the flow a little bit more. Believe in yourself.
Basically, Ref's got one bad attitude.
He's got a bad temper.
Yeah,
he does. Basically, you got a bad temper. You do. We love you, you knucklehead.
No matter who we're fighting, or whatever situation we're in, Michelangelo likes to have fun. He's the cut-up. So even though things may look kind of bad for us, he'll find a way to make a joke about it.
Mikey's a sweetheart of a guy. We all love Mikey.
Yeah,
don't change.
I don't mind him, except the pizza heater sometimes.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah, that stinks too.
He's got eclectic choices, peanut butter and jam.
Donatello is sort of, he's goofy. He's always searching for answers. I mean, he's always fiddling with gadgets and things, so he's always intrigued, very curious kind of character.
Oh, so you want to talk about Donatello? Well, he's kind of cool, but he's nerdy.
Yeah. He's a whiz. Yeah, he's really good with all that electronics.
The costumes are made of latex and take a lot of punishment during a day's shooting, so they must be constantly repaired. Each actor's costume is made especially for him and takes a long time to get on before the cameras roll.
Just put my hands on. You might as well, you know, we'll just do the shell over there.
Hang on.
These are dressers, the backbone of what makes a turtle costume look good.
And they're snapping my knees together.
You'd like that, wouldn't you?
Yeah, this is my knee. Have you ever had your knee snapped again?
Yes, I'm Donatello.
I think.
I'm Leaf. No, I'm Donatello.
Second sticks. Stand by.
I am a puppeteer also, but instead of using my hands, I'm using my whole body. The hardest part is the heat and the weight. And, you know, like the eighth hour into the day, you know, how do I still seem light on my feet when, like, the whole costume is soaked up 30 pounds of my sweat?
It's not going to work.
Yes, it is. They'll eat anything.
We thought, how can you take latex, strap it over an actor, put some wires in his head, and make it believable? But it was just one of those magical experiences that they're that good.
Guys, knock it off. Brother. Keep your eyes peeled.
Well, Splinter, he's probably the most sophisticated hand puppet that's been made. He combines the latest computer technology with some of the more traditional skills of a hand puppet.
Veil by a shadow too deep to penetrate. Until now.
Splinter's mostly worked like a puppet. I put my hand up inside of Splinter to work him. We do have another performer that actually does expressions on Splinter's face. And we also have a puppeteer that does both arms of Splinter. So it takes about three people to make Splinter work.
Come away from there.
Jeez, I was just gonna...
Never forget who you are. You are ninja.
Kevin Clash also records Splinter's voice, but the turtle puppeteer's voices are replaced by other actors.
Awesome!
And so are Toka and Razor.
We've got two new mutants in the movie. They are treated seriously. They are scary creatures. Up until the moment they open their mouths, which is about 1 minute into seeing them.
Get off me!
From that moment on, we play this incredible dance between comedic and serious. And that's the challenge of working with the creatures.
You know, maybe that ugly crack was a little bit out of line, huh?
Another important part of the turtle character is their ability to fight. Of course, Master Splinter teaches them to fight only as a last resort.
They fight because they must, but it is the last choice for the true ninja.
All the martial arts sequences needed to have a lot of the turtle action that kids love. So the movie makers had to be sure that it was all well rehearsed, so no one ever appeared to get hurt.
The first picture we started out, we really didn't think it was violent, but there was somewhat of an outcry from parents saying that this is seems to be excessive. We kind of thought that the turtles, obviously they have weapons, which is basically what they do. I mean, it's very hard for them to fight without using their weapons. And I think we were conscious of that in the second picture. I think in this movie we've taken away their weapons and given them other things to play with, such as the yo-yo, things that they can directly pick up or find that would be not construed as weapons, but the way they use them is very funny.
By staging a lot of perfect moves and flips, you're making the fight look unreal, and you are getting the audience to be fascinated by the gracefulness of the movements. So they're more interested in expecting what new movement is going to come up instead of what damage the movement is going to do.
The producers went to master fight choreographer Pat Johnson of the Karate Kid fame to bring out the individual styles of the four turtles and assure that precision martial arts sequences would not be violent.
All of their ninja skills are relatively the same. In fighting, Michelangelo tends to have the most fun with his fighting. I mean, he's just having a ball.
Can we talk? Guess not!
Beautiful. Donatello, who also has fun, but he does more things by mistake, where he hits people, you know, by accident. He hits someone behind him when he really means to hit someone in front of him. Leonardo feels so superior to his adversaries that he's really taunting them and having fun that way. Raphael is really harassing them. His comedy is more of harassment to really drive them nuts.
You're good! Come on!
We spend literally hours and hours and hours. Everything we do is done in slow motion. We probably spend as much as 10 hours rehearsing one punch that's going to be shown for 1 second to make sure it's done safely.
One thing that people have in their mind anytime they see martial arts is that it's very violent. In the movie, you never really see any, you never see any blood or any stabbings or anything of like that. And most of the time, the fight scenes are comical.
And action.
Stay down. Did I mention I study martial arts?
One of the approaches I like to take with action sequences, and especially fight sequences in this movie, is to first start with a concept and an idea, like the fight in the TGRI lab was basically a football match, pursuit for the football, which is the canister of the ooze. Giving that idea to a choreographer like Pat Johnson gives him room and gives him lots of ideas to put it into very, very specific terms.
Got it. Good. I don't get it.
And action.
Hey, Mikey, he serves up, dude.
Vanish! Now that all the elements are together, it takes preparation and rehearsal for the people in the costumes and those outside to make the secret of the ooze an exciting action adventure with a lot of turtle comedy.
Eclectic? Jeez. Oops.
Everything in this movie had to get pre-planned. Because of the nature of puppets, creatures, special effects, everything had to get worked out beforehand. Rehearsal in this movie was an essential process for two reasons. It gave us a chance to have the puppeteer and the actor in the suit, of the turtle suit, begin to become a team, begin to become one person. But I also used the rehearsal process to begin to overcome the obstacle between the real actor and the actor and the turtle.
I found myself at the beginning looking at these, you know, these faces expressive and falling into all of that. And the child in me coming out going, wow, and that sense of believing that, you know, that they're real. And then I would step back and I'd go, oh, gosh, you know, the actor inside could see me. And I was almost embarrassed going, oh, God, I'm really, like, talking to Donatello.
Any luck finding a new place to live yet?
Well, you know, in this market, it's actually very difficult to find good subterranean housing.
Hey.
With April's help, Splinter and the Turtles battle Shredder and his new mutant warriors to save the world's environment.
Will now be your undoing.
They also discover how they were mutated.
An unknown mixture of discarded chemicals was accidentally exposed to a series of radiated waves, and the resulting ooze, as you put it, was found to have remarkable but dangerous mutagenic properties.
And learn some important lessons about life.
I thought we'd find out we were special.
Do not confuse the specter of your origin with your present worth, my sons.
I don't believe him. There's just got to be more to it.
In the middle of all these adventures, they create a new song and dance called the Ninja Rap. The Ninja Rap has been choreographed to turn everyone's favorite dudes into the most marvelous martial arts dancers around.
There's a combination of elements in the choreography. We try to lay the martial arts aspect of it, you know, this kind of stuff, and the just the strong, powerful percussive hits that come into martial arts against the street dance hip-hop kind of choreography. It's like mutant hip hop.
Devastate the show what the turtles are saying.
Ninja, ninja, rap, ninja, ninja, rap, ninja, ninja, rap.
The ninja rap is performed in the movie by one of the hottest rap groups in America, Vanilla Ice, which makes the song and dance turtle-rific.
Vanilla is here with a new jack crew, gonna rock and roll the place with the power of the ninja turtle bass. Iceman, you know I'm not playing. Devastate the show what the turtles are saying.
Ninja, ninja rap, ninja, ninja rap, ninja, ninja rap.
The Turtles could dance to the ninja rap for a long time, but of course, that's not the end of the story. There is a final confrontation with the Shredder that has a twist to it.
We're not through yet.
But it must remain a mystery, at least for now.
Doubtful. Hey, where'd he go?
I'd say that's pretty much a wrap. Yep, cowabunga?
Hmm? Cowabunga!
Yeah!
Yeah!
Cowabunga!
Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 2 is an exciting action comedy for kids of all ages. The Turtles started with pen and ink and are now larger than life idols who have taught kids a few things. To obey their parents, most of the time. To protect the environment. To only fight in self-defense, and to be teenagers and share their adventures with the world.
I'm Leonardo.
Ninja is a master of himself and his environment.
I'm Michelangelo.
Well, the lives of two people don't amount to a hill of beans in this crazy world, Ilsa. That's why you're getting on that plane. Maybe not today, maybe
would
not tomorrow.
Stop?
Donatello, Frère Jacques. Frère Jacques.
I'm Raphael. Any of you guys ever heard the expression fair fight?
I've said it before, and I'll say it again.
Man, I love being a turtle.
I love